And welcome to the Diana Initiative CTF. My name is Marcel, and I'm one of the organizers for the CTF. So we're going to step through just a few housekeeping type things, and then I'm going to kick it over to Jay for the CTF for Noobs workshop.
Alrighty.
So first off, I want to say thank you to our sponsors. MongoDB is our prize sponsor. They gave us some money to buy fabulous prizes for everyone. And also TriHackMe. We are using the TriHackMe platform for the CTF today. It's the first time I've used it for a CTF, but I think it's going to be pretty fabulous. So excited about that. And then thank you also to Women's Society of Cyber Jitsu and eLearn Security for donating prizes, more fabulous prizes. Okay, so I also want to give a shout out to the amazing CTF team. This is in alphabetical order, but we've got Aaron. Aaron is our MC, and if you haven't been to the CTF Village Room yet, you definitely need to go there and check out the awesome music he's playing. Blue Fox is our prize wrangler, so he's working on putting all those prizes together. Christina is our badass reverse engineer who did some of those malware challenges that you'll be looking at. Jay is our CTF for Noobs workshop person and also built a number of challenges. Jamie built a number of challenges, a web application, which is not my strong suit, so I'm really glad that we had some other folks on the team to do those. Joe did the OSINT challenges. Kristen did a variety of challenges and peer review, which is a huge part of the process. Tabby, also a co-organizer, and did challenges too. Tyrone, same thing, co-organizer and lots of challenges. And he really built out the entire platform in TriHackMe. So I really appreciate that. And Zara, more challenges. And Zoe, some more of the web app challenges. So a fabulous team. Some of these people I've known for years. Others I've never even met. So if you're interested in getting involved next year, hit me up. Okay, so to get started, the CTF is already going. If you haven't started yet, don't worry. It's going to be running the duration of the conference. I have a tiny URL there, but it's basically the TriHackMe site. And you just need to create an account, and then it'll ask you for like a code to join a room, and you can just type in that Diana Initiative CTF. Jump into the challenges, or if you want a little extra assistance, attend the workshop that Jay's giving, where we will be doing some sneak preview walkthroughs of some of the challenges and go from there. So how you play. So TriHackMe is set up for individual play only. If you want to do team play, you would have to create a team amongst you and whoever else, and then use a shared login. So I'm always reluctant to say use a shared login, as I have in the picture there. What could possibly go wrong? But in this case, that's the only way to have a team. So for support during the CTF, you can reach out to our volunteer team in the Capture the Flag Village and just do chat there. If you have like specific questions, send a direct message to me or one of the other admins. I'm in there as literally CTF admin, and we'll announce other volunteers as they're on hand. We're only going to be doing like official support during the conference hours. So if it's in the middle of the night and you're stuck on a question, we probably won't be able to help you. But I'm always happy to see the evolution of chat between the different players and helping each other and stuff like that. So anyway, and you can also create your own breakout sessions within that room. So if you have like a team, you can have a little team group and so on and so forth. Okay, so winners and prizes. There will be both. We are actually still working out prizes because we're getting new things coming in like as we speak. So none of that will be announced until tomorrow. One thing to note is if you decide to go the team route and you have like 20 people on your team, everybody will not get a prize. I wish I could say prize for you, prize for you, prize for you, but it's not going to work that way. It'll be limited. So you'll have to divvy them up amongst yourselves. So that's it. Let's get going and do some some challenges. And I'm going to pass this over to Jay so she can start the CTF for Noobs.
Thank you, Marcel. Hey, look, it could be one person watching or 10 people watching. I'm not sure. I got to make this fun for myself, otherwise I'll go nuts. It feels like I'm talking to myself. Let me get the screen going. Hi, this is CTF for Noobs. There with me. This is my first time doing this training live for anyone. I go by Jay, sociable engineer on Twitter. I'm a cyber tester. I own and operate the Hacker Runway, the shop in the contest. I love doing CTFs. I'm not good, but I love doing them. I am forever a student. I always try to learn new things. I'm a member of the Women's Society of Cyber Jitsu, and you can contact me on Twitter or my email. I can warn you that I probably won't respond to my email as quickly as I will to Twitter. You can find the presentation on the following link, tinyurl.com/CTF for Noobs. I will have someone type that in the stage. Women's Cyber Jitsu have been around for about 7 years, six to seven years. God damn. And it started with a bunch of ladies, and Lisa Jiggett was the creator. But you also have Mary and Marcel. They got together and they started a study group, basically to get women hands-on training that you wouldn't normally find unless you were part of one of the elite groups. So I found them on Meetup, joined them, and expand my slideshow. Sorry, let me do that. Hold up. I am looking for how to do that. Full screen. Better? Sorry about that. I joined the group, did some studying with them. I was able to change career path by working with them and studying for the Security Plus. And that, as you know, is history. Right now, they have over 5,000 members. We're all over the U.S. and we even have some international members. What is a CTF? Today we're here to learn about capture the flags. The original meaning came from capturing the enemy's flag during the battle, you know, during war or whatnot, except we haven't had enough of those. But in InfoSec, capture the flag referred to competition, where you get to solve scavenger-like challenges or puzzles. And your main goal is to find a vulnerability that will lead to something something to compromise the system. So think of the CTF as a practice to what you're doing in the real world. Who can play? For the short answer, playing is for anyone. You want to... you want to join in, sorry, I'm trying not to read the little things that are coming up on the screen. Playing is for anyone. It's for students, then they're usually the target audiences. You have professionals who play these. You have companies, and companies will put out CTFs as a potential way to find new hires. And there's challenges anywhere from beginners to advanced. Why should you play? Because it's fun. I mean, like, you're doing puzzles, you're solving challenges, and sometimes you get a whole lot of money to do this. So it's a way for you to build your skills. Is a great way to learn things. Some people are tactile learners, some are audible learners. You can go and listen to a lecture and walk out of there, be an expert. But for a lot of folks, you need the hands-on for retaining knowledge, and I'm one of those. So I like doing the CTF because it helped me remember all the things that I'm learning by hand. Okay, it's also great for resume building. When you don't have experience, you know, when you get those job listings that want you to come with 100 years of experience before you've even graduated, use your CTF challenges or your CTF experience as a form of experience. Now, I bet you got a lot of excuses. I did too before I started. You know, I'd rather watch. I've never done this before. I don't know enough yet. I don't want to hold back the others because, you know, people are faster and they know what they're doing. And I don't know where to start. Well, start here. I'll tell you a little bit about my first competition. Funny thing is, I don't remember much about the competition except for the fact that I had in the back of my mind that everybody else on the competition were better than me because they had been in competitions before. However, we were all still learning. And we had a challenge where we needed to go in and we were trying to elevate our privileges. And we thought we needed to change the config files. And somehow we ended up changing permissions and locked ourselves out of the system. And that was the end of the game for us. We couldn't log in and we couldn't play. Lesson learned, but that didn't stop me because I left fired up wanting to do another challenge, to do better the next time. So, you know, you get a CTF, you get a CTF, everybody gets a CTF. CTFs are team-based or individual. They can be in-person or, you know, our new normal is remote. And they can be timed or open-ended and from new to advanced. You have all sorts of, you know, something for everyone. There are different categories of challenges. Now, you can't be, you know, you can try to be jack of all trades, master of none, or you can form a team where you have somebody who is an expert in something in each of these. Or you can choose just to focus on one area and let that be your expertise. You have cryptography for those who like to solve puzzles and crack codes. You have steganography for those who like to solve, you know, figure out a way to find images or images and files out of other images and files. You have reverse engineering for binary and exploiting the binary files. You have web application pen testing for those who are, since everybody is in the cloud, you're on the web, a lot of the attacks will come in to that manner. So it's a great skill to have. You can do the root to boot type of challenges where you own the system, upon the system. You can do network and traffic analysis, which is part of digital forensics, where you're going through PCAP files to find data that's exposed and that have been captured on text. Then with the digital forensics, you can do everything from the memory analysis to drive and disk drive analysis. And then you have your specialty type of events where it's the wireless, OSINT, which is open source intelligence. You have trivia sorts and where it's just basically Googling the heck out of stuff. And then social engineering, which is more of a specialty type thing where you are, a lot of times it's set up as a live event where you're calling a vision or trying to get information from people during a live phone call. That brings me into the next one, where your types of competition you will have are the Jeopardy, where it can be a group or puzzles. You have attack defense, mission-based type challenges. A hybrid, which is just exactly what it sounds like. It's a mix of many, two or more. And then you have your specialty challenges. All right. For the offense, attack, defense, you have, those are usually for, I don't want to say elite teams, but they're usually really hard to get into. When I've looked for them anyway, they tend to be like a specialty focus or a smaller type challenge where you have to qualify to get to that. Like DEF CON has their big one where people can do qualifications all year long. And then you have some of the ones that are listed on here with the cyber defense competition and whatnot. Your goal is to lock down your system while attacking your opponent. Usually everybody has the exact same systems that are given to them, and it's just a matter of how fast you can be in locking down your system while trying to compromise those vulnerabilities you find on your system during the event. Yeah. For the Jeopardy style, it's set up like Jeopardy, except you don't have to answer in the form of a question. You have each category will have a point system, depending on the challenge, depending on its difficulty. You will have everything from a 25 point question, which might be your easy, and then a 100 point question, which might be a difficult and challenge. So that's the kind you will usually see. That's similar to what you will see today. We have a hybrid of a Jeopardy and Hack the Box type challenge. The mission-based challenges, I've seen them with Kaizen, I've seen them with KringleCon, which used to be called Holiday Hack. It is based on a scenario you're given, a storyboard, so to speak, where you work your way through the story, and each question you solve is going to point you to the next answer you need. So you sometimes won't even know how many questions you have to solve on the entire CTF board. Questions are revealed as you're going through it. All right, for the hybrid, is a mix of them all, and most competitions tend to be hybrid. Like I said, for today, you're going to be doing Jeopardy style questions. You're going to have your Google Foo challenges, you're gonna have your PCAPs and everything else, but then you also have some hack the box boxes where you're gonna log into the box and then try to elevate your privileges and find a flag, sorry. For the specialty challenges, SACTF, Derby is no longer around, and DC3 is no longer around, but there were specialty challenges. DC3 was all about digital forensics, and SACTF at DerbyCon. SACTF still happens. It's usually at DEF CON, and this year they didn't do it, but it's you're given a company, and over a 3 week prior to the event time, you go and gather information on it. And then you come back and do a live call while everybody is watching you in a quiet booth. Then you have the Wall of Sheep for the Packet Detective. That's also held at DEF CON, where you have PCAP packages that you're being given, and you're going through, sifting through to see if you can find anybody plain text password in the data. Hopelessly Broken is another challenge that has to do with IoT devices, mainly routers. And then you have the Trace Labs, which is relatively new, and it's all about helping real time to find people that are actually missing. So it's not just a game, but it is a way to actually help your fellow human. Now, a slight detour from the Capture the Flag. You'll hear some people refer to Capture the Flag as a hackathon. It's not the same thing. A hackathon is basically where the vulnerabilities have already been found, and now you gather your brightest and best programmers to come together and solve whatever problems you're having. You're doing a sprint. It's usually wrapped around a cause. I've seen them where they're doing them for, a company will have like a particular item that they're putting out, and like say a drone, for example. And they want to make sure that those are going to be secure from someone trying to take it over. So you have a hackathon, and you bring in all your vulnerabilities, and then tell people, hey, have at it. Let's fix this problem, or let's brainstorm to fix the problem. Okay, and then back to CTF. How do you prepare? You want to get your A-team together. You want to find like-minded individuals. I also like to find people who are specializing in other fields than what I know, because I know that I can't be good at everything. So I want to find people who are better than me at other things. Hope that didn't lose you. I almost lost myself. Anyways, you find like-minded individuals. You want to find a focus area and hone your skills. I'll attempt to pick a type of challenge and solve that for a few weeks. And then either I get stuck a lot more and I get bored, and then I move on to something else. But I want to do that particular thing until I feel like I'm pretty comfortable at it, even if I'm not the expert. Then you'll want to build your home lab. Because it is illegal for you to go and hack at things that you don't own, build yourself a lab or join something like the TriAcme platform, where you can go and they have a lot of vulnerable machines that you can log into and hack and not worry about any legal repercussions because you found something you weren't supposed to be looking for. You want to develop your toolkit, basically your set of tools that you're going to be using to make your CTF a lot smoother. And then you want to read and research walkthroughs. A lot of the challenges you see will repeat after time. And if you've read through the walkthroughs, then it's not so daunting and new to you. And even if you're in the middle of a challenge and you can't figure out what to do, if you Google, you might end up with a walkthrough that sounds similar to what you're looking for. And that way you can help build your skills. For building your home lab, you need a virtual machine, a hypervisor that you're going to run your other operating systems on top of. You want your attacker box. It can be Kali Linux, Pentoo, you got Security Dojo, and many other types out there. And you need target boxes that you're going to exploit. You can do the Metasploitable, some older Windows distributions, which you can find at the Microsoft site that they have available. You can do other Linux distribution. You can go to Vulnhub, where they have a lot of vulnerable boxes that you can go and practice on. In our toolkit, excuse the noise for a second. All right, Google, stay with me. Google is your friend. They're invasive, they get on, they get into everything, but they are your friend when it comes to hacking. I Google pretty much everything that I can't find, and then if I don't Google, I duck go it, but it's the same deal. All right, the internet is, it's a playground for you to find, it's also somewhere for you to get led down the rabbit hole looking at videos, but other than that, it's like you want to use Google to find the things that you need to help you. Marcel's GitHub link I posted here, she has a lot of links of places you can go and do to help solve a lot of the problems, especially when it comes to doing like the binary, to do any of the decrypting, cryptography, or doing like password hashes and stuff. She has links to those. If you go to her GitHub, she has like a link to a Google file that you can then follow along. For your basic tool set, you want a text editor, a hex editor, Wireshark, and a lot of these are built into the Kali operating system. You know, for pen testing, you want the Nmap, your burst suite, which is what you use to capture the traffic before it goes to the website, you know, for you to stop and edit things in live when you're trying to mess with the website. Metasploit for doing your easy exploitation on boxes. If you're really good, you can go ahead and write your own with MFS Venom or one of the other exploit type, but these are the easy go-to. Now we're at the part where we do the walkthroughs. First, I can take some questions. Let's see here. I'm not sure if I'm in the right place, but are there any questions? Moderators, do you see any questions on the stage? While I try to, while I log into my hack, my try hack main box. All right. I can't hear you.
I don't think we have any specific questions just yet. Just more general, like how to do things. But my suggestion is for anybody who's in the CTF for Noobs workshop is just relax and try to learn some stuff from the workshop. And the walkthroughs will be helpful.
So. Okay, I have to log into my my TryHackMe.
Okay.
Did not do that. So give me a few seconds, please.
Do you want me to pull it up, Jay? Do you want me to pull up TryHackMe instead, or are you?
No, I just have to. I have to pull up my window. I have to switch windows.
Okay. I have it up if you want to just use mine. Anyway.
I don't know if I can because I won't be able to solve the problem.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah. So I have my Kali. I just need to log in.
Okay. And just a reminder to everybody that we do have the CTF village, and that's where the support chat is. So if you have specific questions, take it over there. And if you have questions about this specific workshop, then post them in the stage chat.
Okay. Let's see. It's the TryHackMe, and can you see that?
Let me look. Yes.
Okay, I just need to find a Diana initially because I have too many rooms.
You have a lot of rooms. You've been using TryHackMe a lot, I see. There it is. All right, I'm gonna leave.
Alrighty. Okay, let's see here. I gotta figure out which problem I'm doing here. Because we're walking through the if you have the slides, we're walking through the cryptography. And we're gonna be doing problem number 7 from task 1. So right here is the problem that we have. And right now it just looks like a bunch of numbers. And you remember I was talking about my cells files. This is the list of all of the links that she has. And for the one that we have, it looks like we're going to be using the ASCII to text because it looks like decimals in the TryHackMe here. So first thing we want to do in this case is copy what we have. And you can also use the hints. Make my screen bigger. How? I don't know how to make the screen bigger. Is that bigger? That's as big as I can get it. Because I'm in the VM. The VM is not going to get any. It's not going to get it any bigger. So sorry about that. In TryHackMe, with many of these problems, we have hints for you to be able to solve. So if you click the hint on this one, it tells you it's a decimal to ASCII type problem. So we copy the the number, go to the Ask You to Hex, and then, oh gosh, it's not changing. Hold on, I'm trying to figure out how to. Sorry, it's supposed to be the whole Cali box, and I want. It's leaving the screen and not traveling. There we go. That's better. So now we've got it going back and forth. So here's the decimal in here. While we paste our value that we got from the TriHackMe and hit convert, up here it has this link, this question that you now have to answer. And the question basically says, if you can't, oh, there we go. Can you see that? Okay, the question says, what year was the Diana Initiative, what's the first Diana Initiative conference? So now, if you've been with Diana Initiative for a while, you might know this off the top of your head. But if you don't, then you go to the interwebs. And I went to Diana Initiative. .org. There you go. And when you go into the about, let's see here. About the FAQs. It's got, let's see here. There we go. They're about the NA Initiative. And as you read through it, it tells you in 2005, they got together for DEF CON 23, but they weren't called the NA Initiative yet. Then they had their first event in 2016, and Diana Initiative wasn't formed until 2017. So then you go back to TriHackMe and type in 2017. If it would let me type in 2017, there we go. And submit, and you see, your answer is correct. Whoop! And you move on to your next, to the next question. Let's see here for the next walkthrough. We have Marcel is going to be doing a packet analysis. So I'll stop sharing my screen, and she's going to hop on to do that. Marcel, are you there? There.
I'm here.
Okay,
I'm bouncing around between the CTF Village room and this room. Lots of
activity. You're a multitasker, a woman of many talents.
Things are hopping. Thanks for doing that walkthrough. That was great. So I'm going to share my screen. Here we go. Okay, so the first thing I'm going to show is the TriHackMe platform. So just a couple of quick things on this. We're getting a lot of questions about just sort of operationally how these VMs work and things like that. Please note that there is a help button right here that will probably answer most questions that you would have. Our team are the ones who built the challenges. We didn't build the platform. So start here if you have questions about how the platform actually works. And then hit us up in the CTF Village chat if you have specific questions about the challenges themselves. And if you've DM'd me a question, I will get back to you. I'm just working on this other stuff right now. So anyway, so there's that. We have a variety of different tasks, as you can see, and Jay, I think just walked through a crypto one. I'm going to walk through a challenge from the forensics category here. So, and as a side note too, if you have a question about a challenge, make sure you tell us like which task it is and which question it is. So like, for example, I'm going to do task 4 and I'm going to do, let's see. I'm going to do a walkthrough on this one question about bob.pcap.ng. So these are links to the actual files. You can download them. Just it's off of Google Drive. If there's a link that's broken, let us know about that. But I think we've checked through everything. So you're going to download this file from the Google Drive link. I already have it, so I'm not going to download it again, but just so you can see how that works. And this is the same with any of the files. The VMs are different, but again, refer back to the help on how to navigate through that. All right, so I'm going to share my Wireshark screen and we're gonna answer this question. How many ping requests were sent in this capture? Which is an easy-ish one to answer, but we'll step through it anyway. So let me switch over to that screen. All right, so let's see. Can I make this a little bigger? Yes, I can. So when I'm looking at a packet capture, and this will help you with all of the questions, right? I typically will start with the menu bar statistics, and I like to start with looking at the protocol hierarchy. So that just popped up in another window. Bear with me while I drag this over. There we go. And this is kind of small. I don't know how to make that bigger, but you can try it on your own too. And this will show us all the protocols that are in play in this network traffic capture. And so the particular question we're asking here is how many ping requests there were. I can kind of scroll down through here and see if I see any ping traffic. I do. There's Internet Control Message Protocol, ICMP, aka ping. If I want to, I can just filter directly from here, but we can see that there's 12 ping packets. So let's apply that as a filter, selected. And Presto Manifesto up here, this is your filter bar at the top. We see all that ICMP traffic, but that's not just the requests, right? So if you drill down into the actual protocol here in the middle pane, which is the packet details pane, I can get this to cooperate. Yes. So we can see this is all like the header information for the packet, and type 8 is a ping request. So we can drill down further on these packets, which I can do by right-clicking here, saying apply as a filter, selected. And now I have a filter that's ICMP type equals 8, which is the code for ping request. And we see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 ping request messages, which makes sense since there was 12 altogether. So ping response requests, so on and so forth. So let's go back over here and put that answer in and hopefully it'll be right. Submit. Yay, whoop, whoop, our answer is correct. So that's a quick Wireshark walkthrough. We might do more of these later, so stay tuned, but I'm gonna pass it back to Jay so she can queue up the next person.
I'm the next person.
Okay. So you can queue up yourself.
Yes. I have one more and then I'll be queuing on. I think Kathy is going to be the one following that. But yes. Okay. So let's see if I can do the screen thing right again. Let's see here. Hold on. This is gonna do something stupid. I don't want it to do. Okay. So sorry, too many try hack me. All right, so for the next problem, we're doing a walkthrough of a forensic, metadata problem. And we're going to be doing the wildlife, who is the owner of this wildlife JPEG. Let's see here if I can zoom in. Can you see that a little better? Hopefully you can see that a lot better. First thing you want to do is download your image. Generally, when you get a question like this, is they're looking for the metadata in the picture. I downloaded, I clicked the link, and it opened up. I then downloaded the picture, and I've already downloaded it, so I won't do it again. And then you can go online and look for an EXIF tool, online, and let's see here, Jeffrey Image Meta Viewer is one of the most popular ones. I would just need to browse to the image. My download file, and here's the wildlife JPEG. Then I make sure he knows that I'm not a robot. I am a robot. I can't see this right. Oh no. Okay, here we go. And then view the image data. And now we scroll to find the user and the owner. If I zoom in on here so you can see this better, you will see that there's the exit data. And whoa, there you go. The owner's name is Wile E. Coyote. And I copy that, take that to the Try Hack Me. Paste it, and you can see you have a hint here that already tells you that the owner's name's got a period in it. A lot of time on TryHackMe, the hint for the answer is going to have the slashes are going to be put in, your periods and commas are usually going to be put in, and then you have to fill in the rest. So paste that. Should we check the hint to see if we did the right thing? Oh, look. We did that. It says EXIF data, use the EXIF viewing tool and look for the owner's name field. And we did that. So we hit submit and we got this. Now, before we go, I want to show you that there's also an EXIF viewer tool within within Kali that's built in. Sometimes you have to install it. So if I CD to my download folder, I don't know, can you see this? Let's see, plus, nope, that doesn't work. Let's see here, I think I can zoom, nope. I am so sorry for this, there we go. All right, and I want to do EXIF tool. And do it to the wildlife JPEG, and it gives me that same information right here, the owner's name, and you would then paste it in, and voila. So right now we're gonna move on to Tabby, and she's gonna do the walkthrough of one of the web pen testing challenges.
Hey.
I will stop sharing and leave.
Awesome. So, all right. So I'm sharing my screen over here. I'm logged into the room for the TryHackMe. And we are going to look at this one here, which is Pickle Rick. So totally full disclosure. I went through this challenge like a month and a half ago when I was QAing it, and I don't remember anything at all. So you're going to get the like real experience of how this happens. So the first thing we're going to need to do is deploy the VM. So we click deploy, tells us this little message, starting your VM. VM has started real fast. So now in a minute, it's going to show us the IP address of the machine that we're going to need to try to break into here. While we're waiting on that, We're going to figure out what we're going to need to do to access that machine. So there's two different ways. If you have not purchased a TriHackMe subscription, but you are using a free account, then you can connect with OpenVPN. And so we will set that up here while we're waiting. I'm going to say, let's do US East Regular 1. I'm going to say download my configuration file. Yeah, I want to save it. I want to save it in /temp. I like to make a directory on my computer for files related to a CTF challenge that I'm working on. Now, I happen to be running Linux, which makes this whole OpenVPN thing really easy to use because it's already installed. You see, they give you this file with information in it, and I can launch OpenVPN like this. And it'll connect. Ta-da, there we go. And I'll put this unreadably small window into the background, and it'll just sit there and run. While we're still waiting for our machine to boot up, we'll also look if you have paid for a TriHackMe subscription. You can also do a browser-based Kali Linux VM so that you don't need to deal with getting OpenVPN working. But OpenVPN does work on Windows, Mac, Linux, and there's directions on the TriHackMe site for how to do it. But if you're a subscriber, then also you can do this thing with the in-browser Kali VM, whatever works easier for you. So I need to get back to the room. We're back here in the room, and a nice thing is the VM that you've deployed doesn't go away just because you navigate away from the room. That would have been a real hassle right now. So we're going to go back and view the challenge here for Pickle Rick. This Rick and Morty themed challenge requires you to exploit a web server, deploy the virtual machine, and explore the web application. Okay, so I don't even know about web application. All I've got is this IP address. I'm going to copy it to the clipboard, and I'll put it in here just so that I can remember it. If I need to remember it, it's right there. I don't know anything about this machine, but good first step is usually going to be do a port scan on it with nmap and see what's listening. So if I just call nmap dash little s big T, it's going to try and do a TCP connection to each of the 1,000 most common ports. And that usually only takes a couple of seconds. All right, it looks like it's listening for SSH connections and HTTP. So probably if we just go to this IP in a browser, that'll be the start that we want. So we'll go into our browser and see what do we get. Brick is super cool. Listen, Morty, I need your help. I've turned myself into a pickle again, and I can't change back. Log into my computer, find the secret ingredients. But I don't know what the password was. Okay, very typical next step in a CTF web challenge is to view the source of the web page. So let's look. And in fact, that's exactly what they wanted us to do here. Note to self, remember username. Username, Rick Rules. So this is probably a useful thing for us to write down. So I'm gonna go down here. If you're not a Linux person, you use whatever you like, but it's good to keep notes. That way you remember what's been going on. Okay, so unfortunately, I don't see any kind of web application. I just see this web page. That's not great. A common next thing to look at when you're looking at a web-based CTF challenge is a robots.txt file. This is weird. This is not what a robots.txt looks like. So you can find out some more about robots.txt. Come on, is there a Wikipedia? Yeah, there we go. Robot exclusion standard. We're clearly not going to read all this right now, but we can scroll. Here's some examples. This is what a robots.txt usually looks like. You say a user agent of a robot and what it is allowed or disallowed to go to. That's not what this looks like. So I'm going to guess that this is a CTF challenge related thing, that this is probably some kind of hint. So again, I'm going to copy this and I'm going to paste it into my notes document here. That may be useful, but we still ain't got nothing. All we've got is this. So at this point, sort of a next kind of step is to see, can we guess other paths inside this web application? Let's see if I've got DeerBuster installed. All right, I got DeerBuster installed. So DeerBuster is a pretty commonly used web application path brute forcing tool. So like it comes with a dictionary file and you can give it a URL and it will start tacking the entries in the dictionary file onto the end of the URL that you start with. So it says here, Derby base URL options. So let's just see what happens if we run this against this in a very naive way. Well, that's chugging away, and I'm feeling kind of impatient. So while that's going, let's go back up to our browser and just try guessing some things, too. All right, pretty good guess. Because, I mean, everybody that writes a PHP web app calls it login.php, right? Let's see if they hit any hints for us in the page source on this one, too. No, we don't got nothing, but we do have the username. And since we found a login page, we're just going to cancel this DeerBuster. It says username. And I mean, God's honest truth, I haven't watched this TV show, but I'm going to guess that if I had watched this TV show, I'd probably recognize that this word wubba-dubba-lubba-dub has something to do with the TV show. So probably. But let's just plug these into the username and password field, see what we get. I'm going to copy, paste, copy, paste. Come on, I need in. All right, cool. So this looks good. We click potions. All right, creatures, other potions, Beth clone notes. We got nothing. We had good luck with finding a hint on the page source, so let's try that again. Anything cool in here? No, but we do have this box that says commands. So this is PHP, maybe this is, oh, and the machine was running SSH, so it's probably running Linux. Hopefully we can get a little bit more information about that. So Telnet is like three decades ago's way of logging into a Unix machine over the network. It's unencrypted, and it's a bad idea, and we shouldn't do it these days. But it also has other handy uses to just connect to any kind of TCP service. And so there we go. This is the SSH protocol handshake from this SSH server, and it tells us that it's Ubuntu. So here we go. We got this Linux machine. Let's try some Linux commands in here. Okay, so we can run Linux commands in this command panel. We're www data. Can we run ls? We can run ls. And here we got this file, super secret pickle ingrid.txt. But note that this looks like it is the root directory for the website. Yeah, so maybe we can just access super secret pickling greed out of the browser. Turns out I actually need this. What do we got? All right, so they let us have this command panel here. We used it to list out some files, and we can actually read the file. Can we also read the file this way? Well, I guess cat being disabled makes it hard for future Pickle Rick, but if future Pickle Rick knows how to use a web browser, we're probably good. I wonder if we can do some Unix trickery here, though. Like read thing, redirect from this. Okay, so if future Pickle Rick has been using Unix for a while, being cut off from cat there isn't gonna hurt him too much. Oh, but more is disabled. But less works. So there's a few different ways we can get the contents of this file. Let's copy it. We're gonna go back to the challenge. I think it means the format. Let's paste it in and see if it likes us. We got it. So we've walked through a little bit of what we can do with the TryHackMe platform, ways that you can deploy machines, ways that you can access them either by running OpenVPN locally or by going to your browser-based access to Kali machine. And we've done a little bit of enumeration, poked around on a website, and we got a flag out of it. So I'm going to hop off here and give this back to Jay.
Hi, Tyrone, are you around? Because we've got the mother load, and that is the pen testing. And he was very instrumental in building a lot of these. And if he's not answering, then you're going to have to do it, Tabby.
All right, we're going to do it live.
Tyrone, call in Tyrone. Oh, wow. Okay, we're being told to also bump up our screen sizes because they can't see the they can't see the screens.
Others, if you can increase like the zoom to like maybe 125%, that's what I had mine at.
Was mine readable? Mine's 150.
Is it? It was still really small.
So. Okay, well, if I end up doing this next one, I'll make it even bigger.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, I don't know what happened to Tyrone, so...
Yeah, what are we going to do then? Let's try something.
Let's do another challenge.
Let's do another challenge. We've got a whole nother hour before this session is done. So, yes, don't we? We started at noon.
Oh, yeah.
Or 9. We started at 9.
Noon somewhere.
Yes. So, okay. So, all right. Go ahead and take it. You can do another
feel better.
Now, okay, Tabitha, can we do, because there's a lot of questions being asked about how to connect to the VPN and
okay, yeah.
Can we just do an instruction on that?
Yeah, absolutely.
I got
Linux. Do either one of you have Windows or Mac?
I have a Windows machine, but I'm using a VM.
And okay, so you just connected the same as I did. You got a Mac. Do you want to do a walkthrough, Marcel, for how to open VPN on a Mac?
Well, I could, except for I haven't actually set it up for TryHackMe for this instance. So it would be like, woo, real quick.
Before that, I also want to address some other questions that came through where they were asking about if you need to have a VM in order to do the challenges. You don't need a VM, however, it is suggested because it will make life a lot easier. A lot of the tools, and when I talked about building your box, your practice box, you have your tools in your Kali machine that makes it a lot easier for you to just be able to build. Now, Marcel, if you're trying to look at the screen in here, it will look small.
I'm not.
Oh, okay. Just check it.
But, I got it in stage 3.
Oh, gotcha. But for those out there who are questioning whether or not they need a VM, if you don't have a VM, you can hop on down to VirtualBox, download, and then go to Kali and download the pre-configured OVA file for your VirtualBox. If you don't have that option right now, you can then try to connect to VPN to your actual machine, but you're going to run into a lot of problems because a lot of the challenges don't always have an online tool available for you to use. So I hope that answers some of your question. I'm going to give it to Tabby, and she's going to show us how to connect to VPN using a VirtualBox. You're not using a subscription one, right? You're using
I just have Linux on my laptop, and I just did install OpenVPN and ran OpenVPN and the file.
Yes.
I want to comment a little bit more about what you were saying about tools and whether you need to have a VM, whether you need to have Linux, whether you need to have
Linux, Kali. Go ahead.
Ultimately, all of this is just using computer tools in unexpected ways. Or in creative ways. And so the right tool is whatever works for you. So if you're a Windows expert and you know all about, how to, write scripts in Windows, a lot of the things where you need to do some data massaging that people would use CyberChef for online. I don't know if we ever showed CyberChef, but it's pretty sweet.
We didn't do a problem like that. There is a problem for it, but we didn't do one.
Yeah. Okay. So a lot of the kinds of problems that people would use CyberChef for, I've been doing Unix since I was a teenager. So I use cat and sort and awk and those kind of Unix Linux tools to do it. If you are a Windows person, you can write scripts in PowerShell to do a lot of this kind of stuff, whatever works for you. So that means, in a lot of cases, you don't need special hacker tools. You just need general kind of how to do computation sort of tools, and whatever you're comfortable with is good. Occasionally, you do get to the point where you need to use some kinds of security specific tools. And in a lot of those cases, a lot of those tools are written for a Unix or Linux focused audience. So I'm pretty sure you can download and run Durabuster on Windows, but I've never tried it because it's just right there in the Ubuntu repo and I'm a Linux user. So yeah. On Windows, one hand, your life's going to be a little easier because if you're using Linux, then you're going to be doing the thing that most people are doing, but you don't have to. Whatever is comfortable for you is good.
So Tyrone said he's ready. So do we want to do the walkthrough? We'll do the OpenVPN after Tyrone, and then we'll go from there. That works? Marcel, I'm going to leave, and then you can let Tyrone. Wait, she left. Why did she leave? Marcel, you're the one letting Tyrone in. Oh, there he goes.
Perfect.
All right, we're going to leave and leave you at it.
Okay, everyone should be able to hear me, right? All right, so what I'm going to do is I am actually going to share my screen. I should be able to hear me. I made the mistake of kicking myself out of the room, believe it or not. So I'm anxious to see how this is going to look, but everyone's all right, so everyone should be able to see my second screen. So this is the Kali Linux machine on one side. I am going to not use that. And you know what feels weird is that I can't hear anything, so I don't know if anyone can hear me. All right. Another tip and trick that you can do for your Kali Linux machine is to set up an alias that will get your VPN up and running. So I'm just going to simulate right now because I kicked myself. I kicked my user out of the room accidentally. So I'm just going to go to the room and maybe I'll just simulate it instead. But I'm going to do the very last one, the pen testing one. I have an alias that will automatically connect to my TryHackMe VPN called VPN2, and it's basically just connecting me. And once I'm connected, then what you can do is just run through the enumeration process, and then from there, you would want to connect to the IP address that it's not going to show up for me right now because I kicked myself out. And then you would start your process. I might have missed a little bit of the earlier portions, but for anyone that doesn't have a Kali Linux VM, TryHackMe does offer the a web-based Kali Linux machine in case you want to connect that way. So the very first question in the variable in the Pinterest prep task. I'm just waiting for it to load it now. And there's a reason why I put this Pinterest prep one together. So anyone that does well here in task 26, then you should highly consider going after some of the hands-on practical certs like the EJPT and the CEH practical. So the very first question would be, what is the IP? What is the, here it is. So I believe that one is, what is the, so you can do that. Oh wow. All right, so the very first question is, what is the host name? So just a simple nmap scan will get you something similar. I can't believe I just did that and not notice. PN-P- means all ports. Want to target the machine and maybe do a --- open. So something like that will be a verbose, fast nmap scan with the service version and the scripts option enabled. The --pn means don't ping. --p- means all ports, IP address of your target. And the --- open simply means only show me the ports that are open. That is a really good initial nmap scan to get you started. You will start to get information based off of that. The way that I created the tasks was as you start to answer these questions, the question will lead you to an answer for the next question. And then by the end, we should all get that secrets.txt, which would be the ultimate goal on the administrator's account. Cool? Yeah, so I see someone who's looking to get into the OSCP. Once you do this pen tester prep, then you should think about how that makes you feel. This machine would be considered an easy machine in the OSCP lab. So just keep that in mind. That concludes. I can always come back at any time to do another demo. I'm gonna need some time to set up another account and get that going. All right. So good luck, everyone.
In QMU. So if we got something we can do before then, while I'm installing Windows, that would be probably to everybody's best interest.
I wasn't sure what was going on. All right, I don't know, Marcel, can you read out some questions we're getting from, because I'm like trying to go back and forth and.
Yes. So, well, a couple of things. We had a couple of questions that have been fixed that people were asking about. So if you were trying something that you thought was right and it didn't work, try it again, please. And then with regard to walkthroughs, everybody should be like in the TriHackMe platform now. So maybe they have some suggestions of something they would like to see us walk through.
It says somebody hit the stop broadcasting. Did we?
No, we didn't.
Yeah,
we're still broadcasting.
Yeah.
I don't know who said that. Anyway, okay. So, yeah. So if there's any requests for walkthroughs, we could do that. We could also wrap this up. It doesn't have to run for 2 hours and just let everybody have at it.
There's that option too. I just wanted to do at least the walkthrough of setting up the VPN since people seem to be having problems with that. I can show what I do with mine, which is just basically from a Linux machine.
And as we pointed out before, I mean, there's pretty good instructions on the TriHackMe platform on how to
do it.
So
being a hacker is read the directions.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm a little bit reluctant to like go over stuff about the platform. You know, we're here to support with the challenges themselves. And I just want to do a shout out to the team again. If you missed my intro, we had about a dozen people on this team, all volunteers, building these challenges for you all to use. And we've been working on it for, gosh, how long? Months, Jay, right? Like, it's been a long time. So,
yes, it's been a good amount of year.
So be patient with us, please. We're all just here volunteering to help you get some CTF exposure and have some fun and maybe win some prizes. I'm open to requests on walkthroughs. So we'll play that by ear, depending on what we get. And I think.
Yeah, I see the OpenVPN would be good is what somebody said.
Yeah, all right. Well, Tabby said she was setting that up, right? So.
Well, she's doing the one from Windows. I can do the Linux.
I'm a little reluctant to do any walkthroughs right now just because I'm dealing with like the chats in the different rooms. So, but James,
no, I can do this one. Okay. I can do the yes.
Okay.
And then yeah.
So you know we could share, Jay, like our history going back doing cyber competitions. Like, how many cyber competitions have we done together now? A lot.
I mean, then it's like a lot of them have been remote just because of the distance, like where we live. In a sense, it's really nice that it's available remotely. We're able to do the challenges.
Yes.
Like we did, let's see. I know the first one I did with Tabby was the Open CTF at DEF CON.
Right?
Yes. She told me that was the first one she had ever done. And I was like, yeah, right. You're like killing everybody here. Yes. So I'm like, my first one, I didn't even know what a Linux box was. And I wasn't that bad, but I was pretty close. It was like, I knew what a Linux was, but I didn't know about OpenVPN. So when people are talking about, you know, like, what are you setting up? It resonated with me because, yes, I was there. And it wasn't that long ago.
Well, you know? You said, Jay, Google is your friend.
Yes,
for sure.
Yes.
So I was just thinking back to, like, my very first cyber competition. And it was a digital forensics competition, the DC3 one that's no longer there, sadly. It was such a good one.
Tell me about that.
But There was one question where you had to analyze a packet capture to figure out like what happened. There was an intrusion of some sort, right? And I was assigned that question from my little team. And I was like, okay, what's a PCAP?
And now you're like the PCAP expert.
Well, who am I?
Well, you're more expert than I am. That's for sure.
Yeah, so, I mean, but it's kind of funny because, you know, when you do these cyber competitions, like, you don't even know, like, the long-term sort of effects that it's going to have. But yeah, like you said, like, here I am, no clue what a PCAP is, and now I'm, like, all about network traffic analysis. And would I have been exposed at some point in time? Yeah, probably, but that got my passion kind of started early. So you already talked about this in your presentation, but I think CTFs are so valuable for so many different reasons. Also, I should mention we have a Women's Society of Cyber Jitsu CTF Slack. I can share the link for that. We've got about 350 people in there. We do competitions together. We build competitions together, like this event. And we pretty much always got something going. So, like, right now, there's a group of us that are doing the Cyber Reason CTF. Not that I have done any of it yet because I've been busy with this and work and stuff. But there's lots of opportunities out there to get involved. So I'll get an invitation link and share that out with folks.
Okay. Let's see here. We got somebody searched for YouTube tutorial, which helped. Great, they're helping each other. Somebody's asking if Tyrone got cut off. He did not get cut off. He finished the walkthrough, and it basically was where he give you the command line, which I typed in the chat box for how to scan, and then once you scan that, it will get you to your answer. I think he didn't want to give you everything.
Tyrone is a little stingy with his hints, for sure.
He is. And you've got somebody asking for the link to the Slack. So
okay. Yeah, I'm gonna pull that up in just a sec. I've gotta go create it, basically make an open invite for people to join.
I see questions about hashes. I can tell you that if you are using say Kali, for example, you have hash ID, which is a built-in identifier, but you can also go online. If you Google, hey, remember Google. If you Google hash identifiers, there are a lot of them out there, and what it will do is give you an approximation of what it thinks the hash is that you're looking for, and that can help take you to your next step of what you want to look for. Okay, we're ready for Tavi to come on and show us how to do VPN from a Windows machine.
All right. So, hey.
Make sure you increase the size.
I'm really sorry to be that girl, but like, I didn't actually have a Windows machine. Thank you all for bearing with me while I installed Windows 7. So, y'all are going to get to see my horrible looking Windows 7. I hope you're not using Windows 7 anymore. But that was the version of Windows that I had an ISO sitting around for and was able to install in a VM here. So I'm here in my Windows 7 VM. There's no video driver, so everything's huge, but we're just going to deal with that. So here we are. And the first thing we're going to want is to go over here to Access Machines and choose Open VPN. So we're here. We're on US East Regular 1. So I can download my configuration file. And it's going to give you this file that's your TryHackMe username .openvpn. And we're going to save it. And I'm just going to save it. I don't know, actually, where did you save it, Firefox? Let's click this little button and see it. OK, so it put it into my downloads folder. So I'm going to copy it, and I'm going to move it to the desktop just because that's going to make life a little easier for me. All right, I'm going to paste this here. There's our OpenVPN file. Next thing that we're going to need is a copy of the OpenVPN software for Windows. And you can get that from Google. You can search for OpenVPN. Make sure that the link looks legit. Yeah, okay, this is legit. So we'll go to downloads. We don't want the source code. I don't remember whether this is a 32 or a 64-bit VM. Let's see. 64-bit VM. So we'll get the Windows 64-bit MSI installer. Going to save it. It's downloaded. Show me here. We're going to run the installer. Yep, we're going to install. And so now we've got the OpenVPN installer running here. Yep, let's run this MSI. You will need to be administrator because it needs to install a bunch of special network adapter drivers for the virtual network adapter that the VPN traffic will come in on. So it looks like we actually have OpenVPN now. And okay, so the GUI says, okay, well, we'll see whether this works. Yep, it's saying if you want your files to be easy to open, you can copy them into one of these directories. But also, I see that my config file also has this nice OpenVPN logo on it. So if we just double click on it, it opens in Notepad anyway, which was not the desired behavior. But looks like the OpenVPN GUI has registered a right-click handler. So I can say start OpenVPN on this config file. And now, what do we got here? Failed to initialize TAP Windows. So I wonder if I need to reboot or if the problem is the driver signing actually being for realsies. So let's reboot our VM and hope it works after we reboot our VM. It's been a while since I've seen this screen. Are you okay, Windows? I hope Windows is okay. I appreciate everybody's patience, as I hope that Windows appreciates my patience. Oh, that was interesting as well. Okay. Yes, I would certainly like to install this driver. Thank you. And that one, yeah, I'll certainly trust that. I mean, I asked you to install it, didn't I? Okay, so those do you want to install this driver prompts seem pretty promising. Still no love with the TAP Windows device. All right. So, can we? Let's see if there is a different one that we should be using. Let's try and go back to a previous one. Let's try this older one. Okay, goodbye, old OpenVPN, or rather, goodbye, new OpenVPN. Yeah, I'll close that because I don't need that anyway since it doesn't work. And now we will try this older, not beta OpenVPN. Everybody, cross your fingers. We're all in this together. Yes, I definitely want all of those default choices. And now we're installing OpenVPN. Yes, please install TAP for Windows. It's the network TAP driver, which I believe is a concept ported over from Windows. A concept ported over from Linux because the OpenVPN software was itself originally written on Linux. And so you need the special Windows drivers to be able to run it. But right now we're installing .NET 4.0. Yes, of course I've read the license terms. I assume that this portion of the whole procedure where you try to get OpenVPN working is easier if you're not on Windows 7. So my apologies for that being the version of Windows that I had sitting around, but I think we'll get there. Check our chat box here. Yeah, you can definitely quote, "Are you okay, Windows?" You know, there was a time when I really hated Windows because I used Macs and I just knew that Macs were greatly superior. And the longer that I have worked in tech, the longer that I've worked on computer security, the less I believe that anything is actually the best, but that everything is good at some things and bad at others. And it's important to choose the right tool for the job. So, you know, I do ask, "Are you okay, Windows?" But I ask Linux the same thing. "Are you okay, Linux? Are you okay, OpenBSD? Are you feeling sick this morning?" Boot my camera button real quick. I did not expect that I was going to be live installing .NET Framework 4 today, but I appreciate everybody's patience with this. Yeah, that's a really good question, whether OpenVPN is working on WSL2. I assume that it can't work on legacy WSL because it has to do so much fancy low-level network stuff that just doesn't exist in the world of original WSL. But yeah, WSL2, where you're really running an implied hypervisor and a real Linux kernel in it, seems architecturally as if it could work. So that could also be an interesting option for people who are on the newest build of Windows 10 and have access to WSL2. I suppose we can interpret this experience as an advertisement for the TriHackMe membership, because you spend your $10 a month and then you click give me a Kali VM in the browser and then you have it, which would also be handy if you were trying to play like from a tablet or something. But I'm committed at this point. We are going to connect to OpenVPN from Windows one way or another. All right. Yeah, we got .NET. I always wanted .NET. Yeah. Cool. General quick start for Windows. Requires a config file. We got a config file. You can run it as a service, but that sounds fancy. Here's how to build it. I don't want to build it. I just want to try using it. So now we'll go back. We'll get a new clean Firefox window and start OpenVPN on this config file. Hey, what do we got here? Windows tunnel adapter succeeded, initialization sequence completed. So I believe that we are now actually on OpenVPN. Let's see if we can deploy a machine. Oh, Firefox, you helpfully saved my username. I don't actually like that. Cool. So we're here in TriHackMe. Remember the room name? All right. I'll use my real hacker voice. I'm in. So now let's go to one of these. Oh, I actually have the Pickle Rick machine still open. So with OpenVPN running, let's see if we can access Pickle Rick. So I wasn't 100% sure that I trusted my OpenVPN connection or the Pickle Rick VM. So I tried going to it in the browser, but it's just spinning. So I've opened up a CMD window here, and I've typed ping and then the IP address. That's also not doing anything good. So either my VM is no good, or OpenVPN was just kidding when it said, oh, Windows route add command failed. Returned error code 1. And why is that? I'm going to try running the OpenVPN GUI as admin instead. Use import menu or copy your... Okay, so let's actually try that. OpenVPN GUI import file. Downloads. Here's my file. Please import. File imported successfully. Connect. Does this look better? Now connected. Okay. I've been fooled before, but... All right, we're here. So let's go back to the beginning and pretend that this all worked from the beginning and go over what the procedure is. So first, we went to openvpn.net and downloaded a stable version of OpenVPN. So we're going to say, we're going to go in here. Sorry about that distraction. We're going to go here and we're going to say community downloads. And I tried and did not appreciate the beta 1. So if we instead go to the maintenance release 249, select your appropriate version of Windows, download it, run the installer through to completion, and you'll eventually get to the point where you can go to your start menu and choose OpenVPN GUI. OpenVPN GUI will show up over in your taskbar. And then you can go to the Try Hack Me webpage. On the left side, under Access Machines, click OpenVPN. Select the VPN server that's close to you. I'm going to say US East Regular 1. You say download my configuration file. Save it wherever it's saved, like in this case in your downloads folder. Go back to your taskbar, OpenVPN GUI. Right-click that thing, say import file. Pick that new file you downloaded. File imported successfully. And now I have two, so I get to choose which one to connect with. Go to it in the taskbar, right-click, find your thing, say connect. Little window pops up, shows you a ton of information about the state of what's going on with your networking. And if you connect well, eventually it tells you, Tabby is now connected. Once we're connected, get back into the Try Hack Me room. Deploy a VM. In this case, I've got the Pickle Rick VM deployed. Copy that IP address and start doing your things with it. In this case, because I know it's a web server, just paste it in the address bar here. And now here, I've connected to OpenVPN on Windows and deployed a VM and connected to our Pickle Rick VM via Windows. I can go to login.php, and if I had the password, then I'd be able to get to the command shell, and it would be exactly the walkthrough that we had before, except on Windows. So I hope that that's helpful for people. There's also the Try Hack Me platform help, which you can get to by clicking this button, how to connect to OpenVPN, and if you click around, you can get to this page, which I will manually type into the chat because I can't actually copy and paste out of this VM. I'll click it to make sure I got it right. Oh, you got to be logged in first. But there you go. That's how you do it live. I hope that you don't have the struggles that I did with the OpenVPN version. But if you're not running Windows 7, and if you choose the release version and not the beta version, I expect that you'll have good luck. While I'm still here on video, we'll take a few seconds if anybody wants to ask any specific questions. And otherwise, I will drop off and we will all wish you well in the CTF. Join us over in the CTF session and we'll be there to text chat with you.
So,
All right. Yeah, thanks a lot. I did do a Linux command quite some time ago when I was on Linux. Yeah, what's the question? Okay. You know, I remember enough of this. We can actually just go right back through this, and I will be happy to describe that. So, gotta type the file name correctly, or it 404s at you. That's not the right thing. We get our username back, which was on the source of this web page, Rick Ruiz. So we'll paste that in here. And the password was in the robots.txt. We'll paste that in here. We get the login page. Yeah, please don't save. You're not helpful. Okay, so So yeah, yeah, it is something with that symbol. So this is a very, very old school Unix-ism, where Unix tools are generally designed to accept data from their standard input and then output data to their standard output. And so if we just use this like it's a Linux prompt, because it basically is, you know, we can run the echo command, hi TDI, and it'll say hi TDI. But now we can run that same command, but pipe it to say the program cat. Oh, and it's gonna smack us because you're not allowed to run cat. So we'll instead pipe it to DD because that will also work. This vertical bar character is the same thing as on the backslash key of your keyboard, and it connects the standard output of echo to the standard input of the next command. Actually, I'll do a little bit of magic here. Just so that we can see that it does something. I remember the syntax for this, it'll uppercase everything for us. I'm going to copy it in case I didn't remember the syntax for it. That's... Okay, so the pipe character takes the output. So the pipe character takes the output of one command and runs it into the next command. So like the example that I just did was, and this is kind of fancy Unix stuff. This is not super fancy, but it's like, you know, this would be Unix 201, not Unix 101. So the sed command can do editing on text. And so this sed command here takes every instance of hi and replaces it with by. But now other things that we can do are like, for example, we can do ls, we can see the files here. And remember, we can't just cat the file, which is the sort of normal Unix way of viewing a file, because the challenge doesn't let us. But there's a ton of other ways to read a file in Unix. So for example, the read built-in command of the shell will take some input and save it into a file. Not, excuse me, a file, save it into a variable. So you do like read my variable. And now this is the other part of the pipe command. So you can put a pipe, the vertical bar, in between two Unix commands, and it takes the one and puts it into the other. But you can also do the less than symbol here, which looks like an arrow pointing to the left, in order to read from a file instead. So when I do this, this command here, which I'll type in over here, is going to take the first line of whatever file you put and put it into the variable myvar, because that's what the read program does. So then, because it doesn't let us do cat, but we want to know what's in this file, now if we execute this, there would be temporarily a Unix shell variable called myvar that contained the ingredient that we wanted. But that isn't good enough. We need to actually see it. But that's echo to the rescue. So now that we have a variable, we can say something like this. A command like this, the semicolon separates two Unix commands from each other. So it says do the thing before the semicolon, then do the thing after the semicolon. So the thing before the semicolon is read the first line of the file.txt into this program read. And the program read takes whatever it reads and shoves it into the variable you specify. After we've done that, then run the echo program. And what I want you to echo is whatever the contents of the variable myvar is. And so we do it, and now we got the flag. Because we could have just catted the flag, but they didn't allow us to. So instead, we did something that was a little bit fancier. Yeah, yeah, Christina, I totally love it. Big shout out to overthewire.org, and especially the overthewire.org room named, I think, Natas? Let me fetch up a link for that bandit. Folks who want to start to learn or practice some Unix skills in a fun, gamified kind of way. Yeah, overthewire.org/bandit. At a previous job, getting through Bandit was actually one of the last parts of training for new people on the Unix team, because it's fun, it's engaging, and it covers a lot of neat stuff. So yeah, if you are new to Unix and you want to learn, you know, your way around Unix command line, honestly, the super ancient book from the 80s called The Unix Programming Environment, the last few chapters of it are a super outdated view of how to write Unix programs, and so you don't really care about that. But the first few chapters are how to use Unix, like as written by a 1980s person. And I love the simplicity of it, because the exact details have changed a lot over time. Like, how do I configure networking on Red Hat 7, you know, is totally new. But the details of, like, how do I view a file? How do I list my directories? Stuff like that has all stayed the same over time. And it's got a very clear writing style. So I'm going to try and get a link to that, too, just because I think it's a great... I think it's still a great reference. It looks like the used price of it is still around $10. It's been out of print since a long time ago, but there's a billion copies of it floating around. It's called The Unix Programming Environment. There's a million other books if you like books for like intro to how to use Unix, but this one happens to be my favorite, which tells you something about the book and also tells you something about me. So I hope that this has been fun. I'm gonna drop off, but we've got some great links here in the chat for some Linux things. Thanks a lot for asking interesting questions, and have fun at the CTF. If you want to start to learn something about Kubernetes, I highly recommend you check out challenge number 19, the VM called 7. There's a lot of hints baked into that one. So if you check out the hints and play with it, have fun, please come and attack my Kubernetes cluster.
Okay. Thanks, everyone. I am trying to share my screen right now, but my screen has decided it doesn't want to be shared. Boy, it thinks it's already being shared. But we'll see you in the... Go ahead and ask your OpenVPN question. I hope I can answer. You're welcome, Hema. I think that's how you say that. Let's see here. I don't understand why it won't let me. All right. I will see you guys in the other room. I hope the admin's in here to take over. Thank you, Tabby, for the walkthrough. Thanks, Tyrone, and thanks, Marcel, for your walkthroughs. We will be in the session room if you've got any questions.